everybody, and welcome to Zakim's Kitchen Home Edition. I'm Stephanie Meyers, the Nutrition Coordinator for the Zakim Center for Integrative Therapies and Healthy Living. And I'm really happy that you have joined us today to discuss fermented foods, where we will be spotlighting a recipe for kimchi. And if you're new to kimchi, please don't feel intimidated. This is only my second time making it, so I'm a beginner and a novice in this one too. Learning right alongside you, as I loved being with these conversations. So just like usual, I'm joined by our moderator, Lauren Orsillo, and thank you, Lauren. She will be helping with a couple of really important things as we carry on in the next half hour. If you have a question, a comment, or something you'd like to share related to kimchi or otherwise, feel free to type it into the chat at any time, and Lauren will take care of asking those questions. She will also send an email at the end of the day today with the slides from today and all of the links, including links to the recipe. So you don't have to take notes, you can sit back, relax, and decide if kimchi is something you want to put on the menu. I also just want to say thank you for the ongoing recommendations for themes you'd like to see us present, both in Zakim's Kitchen and Ask the Nutritionist. Your themes and your ideas and your suggestions are really the heart and soul of the programming. So if there's something you're hoping for, something you'd like to learn to cook, provided I know how to cook it, then we'll do it. So send those suggestions along with your evaluations at the end of the day, and thank you again. So as usual, we'll start with the slides. Today, this topic, actually, I should mention, was also something suggested by one of you, fermented foods, so thank you for that. And I wanna start with talking a little bit about what does it mean when I say fermented foods? And the foods I'm usually, well, most commonly pop into mind when you think about fermented foods are things like kimchi, kefir, kombucha, sauerkraut, miso, and even sourdough bread. So I have found, like, just in a general survey of friends and family, that a lot of people have started, if the pandemic has enabled them to think a little bit more, have a little more time perhaps to spend in their kitchen. And some people have really taken an interest in trying to figure out which of these fermented foods they might be able to start making at home. So today we're choosing kimchi on purpose because it's the vegetable version, and it's something else to do with cabbage than just make coleslaw. So I like the vegetable component, of course. Not that kefir and kombucha aren't, you know, things you could also make at home. The kimchi is also a lower sugar food, so the kombucha tends to have quite a lot of added sugar. And kefir is using milk and kefir grains, and the milk has to sit out on the countertop for at least 24 hours. So in thinking about how to introduce fermented foods, particularly to a group that's cancer-minded or thinking about cancer prevention and survivorship, I wanted to be thoughtful about the fact that not all fermented foods homemade that sit on a countertop for a period of, let's say, 24 hours on a hot, humid day in the middle of July would be something you'd want to do, especially if you are immunocompromised or have undergone a stem cell transplant. So I'll talk a little bit more about that, but that all goes into the rationale for why I've chosen to demonstrate for you today kimchi as our recipe. All right, so let's just spend a little bit of time on food chemistry for those of you who are interested in how things happen. Fermentation is how kimchi, kefir, and miso are made. And it's a metabolic process where microorganisms actually change components of a food. And in this example, when we make kimchi, we're relying on lactic acid, which is a bacteria. And that will break down elements of the cabbage to produce a host of biologically active compounds. One example of a biologically active compound that happens during fermentation is called conjugated linoleic acid. These are sort of like end products you can think of in the fermentation process. And it is these end products that are derived from the process of fermentation that may have health benefits. And they also help preserve food. This is fermentation is really popular these days, but it's not at all a new technique. In fact, it's been around for a long, long, you know, hundreds and hundreds of years as a way to preserve food and extend the shelf life and, in fact, enhance flavor. So I think those of you who eat kimchi or drink kefir, perhaps, or, you know, sauerkraut eaters, you understand the sort of tangy quality that these foods imbue. It's because of the fact that they ferment, and the fermentation process itself creates active compounds that are not otherwise available for our use in the food.
So the question really, I think, when the person who suggested this topic for today was really, I think, getting at the heart of whether or not there are benefits to eating fermented foods. So I want to speak very generally on this topic because that's where the state of the research is at. And then I also want to just make a brief comment about cancer and fermented foods to the date, you know, sort of up-to-date knowledge that we have. So when we think just generally about fermented foods, there are some properties and potential effects that these foods may offer us, including prebiotics. And so prebiotic is a term I know many of you are familiar with, but prebiotics are the food for the healthy bacteria that naturally colonize our intestines. So something like kimchi is a prebiotic, and when we eat it, it helps feed the friendly bacteria that are meant to colonize and help our intestinal tract. In addition, fermented foods offer antimicrobial benefits and antioxidant, and in fact, even anti-inflammatory benefits potentially. And so epidemiologic research is going on in humans to investigate the clinical benefit of eating fermented foods. And some of the conditions that appear to have a possible correlation include type 2 diabetes, metabolic syndrome, heart disease, and weight management. I've put a couple citations here, not for you needing to go looking for them on your own, but for those of you who are science-minded and like to keep abreast of the status of research on these topics, just know that some randomized control trials are happening, but not clearly and not causally connecting cancer as a benefit of eating, or cancer risk, I should say, as a benefit of eating fermented foods. So there have been some trials looking at whether or not people who eat fermented foods have a lower rate of cancer or overall mortality from cancer, and those studies have not been conclusive. So I just think we want to be careful when we think about fermented foods. They're sort of publicized or touted as being sort of a panacea, when in fact they probably are not, but at the same time, they actually probably offer us quite a few general health benefits, and also potentially some health benefits that we don't fully understand yet when it comes to the research. So my bottom line with why I think including and incorporating fermented foods is of benefit aligns with this article from the Harvard School of Public Health and the Harvard Health newsletter. The link is here, and Lauren will include this in the chat as well as the email she sends today. That the real benefit as we understand it to date is that fermented foods add pre and probiotics to our digestive tracts, and that really we do understand now that the gut flora, those are the bacteria that line our intestinal system, those bacteria are important in more than just helping our digestive system. They actually interface with different systems and pathways in our body, and so they influence our immune system and perhaps our inflammatory response to different and in different ways. So I think there's a lot left to be gleaned in terms of the precision and the mechanisms by which fermented foods can impact human health. But I do think it's worthwhile to incorporate them into your diet in a responsible way, taking into consideration, as I mentioned before, if you have had a stem cell transplant, or if you're in the midst of chemotherapy and needing to follow very specific food safety guidelines. Okay, so today we're going to make kimchi, I already mentioned, which is a Korean fermented cabbage. The flavors of kimchi, for those of you who have not had it, are really just dazzling, in my opinion. It's this umami, spicy, sour, kind of a tangy flavor that really gives food extra zing. And you don't eat it on its own. Typically, you add it to things. So we eat often with stir fry, different types of dumplings atop a salad, even grilled fish or chicken. It's a condiment, so you can really get creative with using it in a lot of different ways. And I want to just share a few things about the recipe and then about the method, and then we'll dive into making kimchi together. So the recipe I'm going to demonstrate for you today is a vegan kimchi recipe, authored by the Simple Veganista. And the reason I'm choosing a vegan recipe is this. Most recipes for kimchi include some type of a fish sauce, or like a shrimp paste, oyster sauce, anchovy paste, fish paste or fish sauce of some type. And I've had so many clients over the years who find that taste or that flavor problematic. during their treatment. So I wanted to share a recipe with you that does not include fish sauce. If you like the fish sauce or you're open to that, the recipe on the next slide will be for you. I also chose this recipe because there's a particular Korean spice that I'm probably about to mispronounce called gochugaru. And this is the spice that's classic, the traditional spice used to make kimchi in Korean recipes. But unless you have already have this gochugaru on hand in your spice cabinet, you're going to want to find a replacement. So this is another reason I'm choosing this recipe. I don't happen to have that spice on hand and didn't have time to get to my nearby Asian market. So this recipe calls for equal parts of paprika and cayenne pepper. So I went with this recipe thinking that these are things many people might have on hand. And then, of course, if you're trying to ferment a food, you're going to need some source of sugar. But what I love about this recipe is rather than adding sugar, they use an unpeeled apple. So we're adding more fiber and more phytonutrients. So this recipe is a real winner in my opinion. Now, as I mentioned before, for those of you who want recipes that include both fish sauce and or miso, this first recipe from Live at Learn is a kimchi recipe that uses miso. And the second recipe here from thekitchen.com is another delicious kimchi recipe. And this one does contain fish sauce. But the other thing I really appreciate about this link is she does a video overview, which is about 1 minute. And it's going to take everything we do together. If you forget the tips and techniques and you want a very quick refresher before you make your kimchi yourself, thekitchen.com, how to make easy kimchi at home. This video link is great. So a few last thoughts before we get to our recipe. You want to really be thinking about clean supplies. So just like you would with canning, you want to have a sterile mason jar. So I just tossed my mason jar in a big pot of water and boiled it for 10 minutes and let it air dry. And that's all you need to do. You don't have to take it further than that. You don't have to sterilize the lid and the ring. You just need to get the glass jar nice and clean, especially if you've been putting other stuff in there on a regular basis. You don't want other bacteria to interfere with your fermentation process. Same for, can be said for the hands, clean hands. We're gonna use gloves, and you'll see most people use gloves at the point where we add the spices to the cabbage. Just if you wanna protect your hands from the smell and the spice, that can be helpful. And the rest of it's gonna be pretty straightforward. There's a process of brining the cabbage, and I'll tell you about that, and that you're gonna let the cabbage sit for 2 hours. And then the rest of it's just making the sauce in the food processor or a high-speed blender. And then you just mix those two things together and you leave it on your counter for 24 hours and then you put it into the fridge for up to a month. And it will continue to get stronger and more tangy as time goes on. And so we're gonna make this recipe in 1 minute, but I just wanna say one more time that leaving things out on the counter for more than 4 hours is not okay or acceptable for people who have undergone stem cell transplant within the past year. So if you or your loved one is in that category, this is not the recipe for you. We really want to adhere to food safety guidelines and make sure that those who are making kimchi have the immune bandwidth to handle it. Like again, this is, we're not creating a dangerous bacterial experiment here, but the people who have experienced a stem cell transplant have very specific guidelines in terms of food safety. So I just want to be sure that we're clear on who should and who should not be making this recipe. Okay, so with that, I'm going to talk you through how you make homemade kimchi. I have my cabbage already brined. So this is step one, and my hands already washed. So we're ready to go, and I have my clean mason jar over here. But I just want to show you, since I already brined the cabbage, I want to show you what the process was, just so you feel comfortable to do this on your own. So that you start this recipe with a 2-pound cabbage. You can use Napa cabbage. That's what's most traditionally used. I did not have Napa cabbage. I had a Savoy cabbage, so we're going with that. That also works just as well, I have found. And the first step is you put this cabbage into a big bowl. Mine is a little wet. And I'm gonna save this bowl, actually, because we're gonna use it in a minute. But I'm just gonna show you here. You sprinkle the salt, kosher salt, over the top of the raw cabbage, and you're not going to cook it. But just like we've been talking about in recent episodes of Zakim's Kitchen, where you massage kale or other greens,
You sprinkle the salt on the raw cabbage and then you massage it with your hands. So you actually get your hands in here and you squeeze the cabbage and massage just like you're seeing me do here. And that you'll do for about 1 or 2 minutes until the cabbage starts to get a little soft. It's not going to get fully wilted, but what you're starting to do is break down the cell walls. And once you've salted and massaged your cabbage, you're going to put it into a big bowl and you're going to pour water just to cover it. I want to give you a tip. I use distilled water when I'm making kimchi because if your water supply is chlorinated, it can interfere with how effective the kimchi and the flavor. So if you have filtered water, that's fine. You don't have to use distilled water. Chlorinated water is fine. I read somewhere along my research and when I was learning to make kimchi, like I said, this is only my second time, but it can be helpful if you use distilled water. So I happen to have it on hand.
Stephanie, we had a quick question. Sorry to interrupt you.
Yeah.
Can you just repeat what types of cabbage are okay to use? Someone wants to know if you can make it with regular cabbage.
Yes, this is regular cabbage. This is just a regular green cabbage. And it called for a 2-pound cabbage. Mine was closer to 1 pound. So I'm just using half of the ingredients. So yes, you don't even, any type of cabbage will work. Napa cabbage is the traditional, but that's the Asian style longer cabbage, but you don't need to have that type of cabbage. I've made it before. The last time I made it, I also made it with just a regular green, small green cabbage, and it turned out just fine. So great.
That's great. Thank you so much.
Of course, yes. And that's, keep those questions coming. Please don't worry that there's any interruption. Just chat away and Lauren will take care of getting those in. Okay. So we've got a clean bowl and we've got cabbage that has been brined. And what I mean by brined is after I salted it and massaged it, I put it in the big bowl and covered it with water. And I put a plate on top to weight it down. Otherwise the cabbage just starts sort of floating to the top. So you put a plate on and I just put something heavy on top like a can of beans or a glass of water to weight it down. And then you just let that rest for 2 hours. And that process I've already done. And then you rinse the cabbage off to rinse that salt away. So I've taken care to already rinse my, that's why it's in a colander. I rinsed my cabbage, all the salt water off, and now it's drained and it's ready to go. So now we're at step two where we're gonna make the sauce for the kimchi. And it's so simple. This recipe is the most straightforward one, like I mentioned. And as before, I mentioned there's no fish sauce, no sugar, and no gochujang. I can't say that word. Anyway, so here are what the ingredients you need. We're going to use an apple. And you see, I didn't peel it. This is about a half of an apple with peel on. And a half of a small onion, your second ingredient. And a tablespoon of minced ginger and 1 clove of garlic, which I've put together in this bowl. So we have 4 ingredients. Apple, small onion, minced ginger, and garlic. And then the spice we're gonna use is a combination of paprika and cayenne pepper. We're gonna put in a tablespoon of each. Now this is the reason I like to make kimchi at home. You can make it as spicy or as mild as you want. So if you don't really like a lot of heat, then just cut back on the spice. So I've got paprika and cayenne. And we're just gonna need a couple tablespoons of water to get this to blend up. So I'll just pour in a little bit of water. We just want this to make a little a paste. So I'm gonna stick this on the blender and give it a little spin. And then we'll be ready to put together our kimchi. You can use either a food processor or a blender to make the paste. Ooh, it smells so good. I'm gonna tilt this for the camera so you can see it's quite thick and it's very fragrant. So that's ginger and garlic and onion and apple and those spices mixed together. And now we're just gonna take our cabbage, which has already been prepped, and put it into this bowl. And this is the part, if you're using the Korean spice, you're gonna wanna get gloves on. So I'm going to demonstrate it using food-grade latex glove or vinyl gloves to help you see how you would do this. It also just gets messy, so that's another reason I sometimes put the gloves on. Also, if you have any little, if you have a cut on your hand or something, it really can hurt if you get this paste into your sore spot on your hand. Okay, so the other thing that people will add to kimchi is things like shredded carrots or daikon radish, or in this particular recipe, they just call for green onions, scallions. So I took 3 or 4 scallions and just sliced them in like sort of 1-inch segments. And that's gonna get added to the cabbage as well before we add the spicy sauce. So we've got our brined cabbage and our green onions. And the other things I mentioned, you can put in if you like. For today, we're just gonna keep it simple. And we're gonna add in our paste. We want all of it. So I'm putting this all in the bowl. And now we're going to work it again with our hands. So this is going to be how the fermentation process gets started. So the lactic acid bacteria left over from the brined cabbage is going to start interacting with the acidity here and create this delicious tangy flavor. So it's just going to look like this. And I'm going to hold the bowl up to show you how we want to coat it. So you're going to try to get the cabbage all covered in this sauce. And it doesn't take very long. It happens pretty fast. If you don't have gloves, just use a clean wooden spoon. And you'll now see that we're already done getting this coated. All the pieces of cabbage have that nice sauce coating on them. And we just grab our clean mason jar. And we start putting the cabbage in. And what you want to do with this is you want to get all the cabbage. I should have gotten a funnel. Make a mess. You want to pack it down. So you can just use your hand for that. You're trying to get this nice and tight so that the sauce gets a coating all over. And you also need to make sure you leave at least 1 inch at the top of the jar. Because as this starts to ferment, there are going to be gases that get released, and you need enough space for that to have the volume of the gas to be contained in the jar. Now, almost there, got just a little bit more, and you can see, it's always a guessing game if the amount I have is actually gonna fit into the jar I bought of. And like I mentioned before, packing it down is fine, so you can see we're gonna have enough space here at the top of the jar to make sure we can get gas release. We have plenty of headroom actually. And that's it. You're going to let this now sit. You want the brine to be, you want the cabbage completely submerged in brine. So it's coated. And we actually could, in some cases, add, when I clean my blender out later, I'm actually going to pour the rest of this because there's a little bit of liquid still in here that I want to get in the jar too. But that's it. Gloves come off and we're going to seal the jar. And we're going to let it sit on the counter for 24 hours, and it's just going to begin to ferment.
We got a quick question here, sorry. A couple of questions on what size mason jar you have right there.
This is, great question, the numbers are just, I think this is 1.5 liters. Oh, no. Sorry. It's 800. 800 milliliters.
800 milliliters. I can do a quick Google. I was going to say I can Google the conversion. Yeah.
800 milliliters.
Thank you.
And again, this I was using about a 1 pound cabbage. But the other way to go is if you have 2 or 3 mason jars, you can just make 2 or 3 jars at a time. That also works.
Great. Thank you.
Yeah. What was another question, Lauren?
That was it. There was just 2 questions. Same question.
Sounds good. And I just want to say some of the recipes you'll read suggest keeping this kimchi on your counter for 1 to 5 days. But I want to be clear that the goal here is that we're keeping food safety at the forefront of our minds. So in my opinion, keeping it on your counter for 5 days, especially in a Boston summer, is not going to be the plan. I'm advocating you just give this 1 day and then put it in the fridge because it will continue to ferment, albeit at a slower pace. It will still continue to ferment when it's in the fridge after 24 hours. And also, I would just say, if your kitchen is bright and sunny, you know, you don't set this in the window with the plants. This should go in a cool, dark area, even in a cabinet or cupboard where it's cool is fine. It's better to keep it in a place like that than to keep it in a hot, moist environment. Also, sometimes if you get a really good ferment, the brine will actually bubble up. You'll see some bubbles in there. That's actually not a bad sign. That's just an indication of fermentation. But this should never taste rancid. What you're looking for is a little zing or tang. But if it tastes, sour is definitely part of the components of what this flavor of kimchi is. But you can taste it after 24 hours, and you'll know if it's headed in that direction. If it feels a little pungent and a little bit spicy and a little tangy, you're on the right track. And then you just keep it in the fridge. Like I said, that reminds me, people often say, well, how long does this last? In this, after your fermentation, you can keep it in the fridge for 1 month. And after that point, I mean, this is not a huge batch, so this probably won't last a month at our house, but a month is the length of time I would keep this in the fridge at temperatures that, you know, proper refrigeration temperatures.
We had another question come in. I actually don't know if I'm going to ask this right, because it's a little, I don't know, I might not just have the medical background for it, but you might, so I'll ask the question. If you experience cancer-related flushing, would you recommend keeping it on your counter for less than a day, or maybe just reduce the amount of spices in it?
Good question. I would definitely titrate back the amount of spices, and that's another thing I like about using the paprika and the cayenne. You can go half or even a quarter of the spice and it will still be reasonable to do. The other way you could decide how long to ferment is if you've ever eaten kimchi that you've gotten in the grocery store or if you've gotten at a health food store. If you have experienced symptoms of flushing when eating an otherwise commercially prepared kimchi, I would definitely go light on the fermentation on your home brand, your home version. You can do as little as 12 to 16 hours. Like, for example, you could make this and then just put it in the fridge tonight before you go to bed, and that would still be fine. Remember, it's not hurting it to go in the fridge. It's just slowing down the fermentation process. So the longer you ferment it, the stronger the flavor and the more fermentation compounds will be present. So that is definitely something to consider, particularly for those who experience carcinoid related flushing. You can adjust the amount of spice and also the length of time you keep it on the counter.
Thank you. That's great. We haven't gotten any other questions, but if anybody has any more questions, we have about 2 minutes left. So feel free to enter in your questions or any comments or anything like that. We're happy to answer them before we head off here.
And I'll also just take this opportunity then to mention what we're up to tomorrow and next week. So tomorrow on Ask the Nutritionist, which is at 12:45, we'll be talking about takeout and tips for ordering and eating takeout. I know many people have been missing the chance to go out and eat in a restaurant and have been moving in the direction of getting delivery or takeout and wanting a little bit of guidance around to do that, how to do that in the most healthy way. So that's tomorrow, Ask the Nutritionist at 12:45. And next Wednesday at 1:15 on Zakim's Kitchen Home Edition, we're going to talk about Swiss chard and some interesting and fun and creative ways, recipes you can use with making Swiss chard. And as promised, my focus for the next several weeks on Zakim's Kitchen is going to be stuff that comes in your CSA box or produce in season in Massachusetts that's showing up at your farmer's market or perhaps even in your own garden. So I have had Swiss chard in my farm share the last 2 weeks. And it's absolutely delicious, and I've been experimenting with some new recipes for that. So if you have been getting Swiss chard, growing Swiss chard, or buying Swiss chard at your farmer's market, and you're looking for some new recipes for that, I hope you'll come back next Wednesday at 1:15 for Zakim's Kitchen.
Thank you. You actually touched upon this at the beginning. We had one more question come in. So you gave us the recipes for how to make the kimchi, but we're looking for some recipes on what to use the kimchi like a recipe that you would incorporate that into.
Yes, you would just don't even need a recipe for that. Just start adding it wherever you like. I think it's wonderful stir fry. It's delicious with scrambled eggs. So anything that needs a little pop, I use it also with grain bowls. So if I'm making a brown rice bowl with grilled chicken or salmon, I'll put a little of this on the side. So think of this as a more interesting and helpful condiment in anywhere you can try adding it. Fried rice, tofu stir fries, dumplings, noodle dishes. And like I said, I've even just used it alongside grilled fish and a tofu. So I'm curious to hear if those of you are going to give it a try, or perhaps you're just going to buy some at the store first to see if kimchi is up your alley and something you'd like to devote time to making at home. I'd love to hear your comments and thoughts.
Awesome. I know we're out of time. We did have two more questions come in. Should we answer them now? Is that okay?
Go right ahead, Lauren, yes.
Okay, so one of the questions was, is the spice necessary for the fermentation process?
Yes, it does help the fermentation process. It's part of the overall way the acidity gets going and the lactic acid feeds together with the spice. So it is important to have some spice, even if it's less.
Okay, thank you. And another question was, do you recommend a resource or website which helps identify different local CSA veggies? For instance, getting scallions with purple bulbs and possibly Japanese turnips.
Great. So yes, if you live in Massachusetts, mass.gov has their farmers website. And on that, you can find farmers markets at the moment are perhaps the best way to see if there's CSA openings. I know many of the CSAs in this area are sort of like have tripled and quadrupled in subscription this year. So there may not be a subscription slot available for this summer semester, if you will. But many of the farm shares in Massachusetts also do a late fall and winter share. And those signups have not happened yet. So you still may have time to join for later. So I'd try the mass.gov farmers market website. And from there, identify your local farmers market. And then beyond that, you can contact the vendors at the farmers market. You can also just look on their websites to see if they offer CSA and farm shares. And I think that's all the time we have. So I just want to thank everyone again for being here again today. I'll hope to see you tomorrow at 12:45 and again next week at 1:15. Thank you, Lauren. Everyone be safe, be well, and have a great afternoon.